Welcome to week two of the European Tour Picks and Bets Show. Skyler Hoke here for another awesome week of European Tour action. We're kicking off with the Omega Dubai Desert Classic this week. I'm here with Tom Jacobs once again. Tom, how's it going?
Yeah, thanks for having me back for another week. I rode the coattails of your pick last week, so I hope to make more of a contribution here this time around.
Man, it was a fun week. I mean, what a start to the year. I mean, that final two groups, I mean, to have Rory and Hatton dueling on Sunday. Hatton, I mean, arguably the hottest golfer in the world over the last kind of 18 months. I mean, that was some great golf to watch.
We were just saying in the podcast we've just done now, and there's nothing really standout about his game. There's nothing. He doesn't drive the ball the best. He doesn't hit the irons the best. He doesn't hit wedges the best. His short game is very, very tidy. It's very solid. I just think he has that hidden factor of confidence, right? He's just the most confident golfer in the world maybe at the moment. And he just has an inner belief in everything that he does. He doesn't deviate from his own game. And look, you know, he turns up to these European Tour events and they're nothing to him now. You know, he's the most Rolex wins now out of anybody's overtaken Jon Rahm. Makes his money there and gets back to the PGA Tour when it matters.
And he's an incredible actor, too. I mean, the Angry Golfers skit that came out over the weekend. I mean, those guys are the best. You know, I mean, it was fun. I mean, unfortunately, Tommy, you know, kind of struggled on that last, you know, handful of holes. It was fun to see him get back into contention. We had the wind to play a little bit of a factor. It was a great start to the year. And of course, you know, we went into that event saying, hey, we're fading the top of the board. There's some rust. There's some question marks. And thankfully, David Lipsky played well enough as Friday through Sunday tied for fifth, actually caught a little bit of unfortunate luck with Mark Warren making every single putt possible on the weekend to split that. Hopefully you had a book that was offering six places for you so you could have that each way payout in full. But, you know, that was a good start to the season. You know, you kind of make a little bit of a profit starting there and then continue on to another fun event.
You can't account for what Mark Warren did on the greens. I think it was something ridiculous. I think he nearly 14 strokes gained on the greens, and that's phenomenal. It doesn't happen very often. Mark Warren doesn't do that very often. He's a great player in his own right, but Lipsky did have a bit of tree trouble on one of the holes. I think he advanced his ball about 5 yards at one point, but generally speaking, he played super badly, and I kept you updated. I know you were out and about over the weekend, and he was solid. You know, if it wasn't for Hatton's brilliance, he'd be able to stay in touch. Yeah. It looked like Fleetwood was going to get done by the draw. It looked like there was going to be a lot of wind in his part of the week. And then there was that massive delay because of fog, and that petered out and managed to bounce back after a tough start. So Rory and Tommy showed their sort of fragility on the final day, which was disappointing. But Tyrrell Hatton did what he needed to do. And here we are talking about another event with him in it.
Yeah, and that's kind of where we'll roll right into this week. And another spectacular course to get to play at. If you get a chance to tune in to the Omega Dubai, I mean, at the eighth hole, the background that they have, you'll see all the guys on Instagram posting the skyscrapers. I think the Dubai scene is one of the best that you get on the European Tour. We'll be at the Emirates Golf Club. Par 72, just under 7,400 yards. Lucas Herbert won this event in 2020. Big Bad Bryson with the win in 2019. And Hao Tong Lee won it the year before. You get a mix of Sergio, Danny Willett also winning here. You had that Masters connection when they won at those back-to-back years there. So what's your take on the course?
Look, there's not much to it. It's kind of a resort course, wide open fairways, which I think allows other people to come in. If you're in form and you've just played well, you know, in Abu Dhabi, you're generally going to be coming here with a lot of confidence. But to me, there's a very strong correlation between this and the Portugal Masters. I think just because of the wide open fairways, the birdie chances. I mean, last year, Herbert beat Bezuidenhout in the playoff at 9 under. But there was a lot of wind. And we'll get on to that in my first or second pick. On the final day, which threw a lot of people off. But generally speaking, it's a 20 under, 23 under par kind of event. So there's the Portugal Masters and the Qatar Masters as well. It's very similar. It was until they changed the course this past year. So anything, those two courses you look at, and we'll reference a couple of guys here with those links. But for me, it's a pretty easy test. And if you're informed, you can come and contend here.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. And I love kind of the knowledge and getting to branch out, speaking to you every week, just the intel you have on these courses and kind of the connections and players that play certain areas a little bit better. I mean, the European Tour, like we mentioned, comparing it to the PGA, it doesn't seem to be the same type of courses where, it's just a straight wedge fest that you need to get and get hot with the putter. We love the talented golf on the PGA Tour, but the European Tour offers a different skill set, a variety of golfers that, you'll see with our card this week. Not much crossover actually with who we were on last week. And again, it's only the second event to start off the European Tour season, so not many had played prior to last week in the calendar year, or really in the end of December. So we're hoping this is a little bit more wide open and not the top of the board being the three finals going into Sunday. So we'll kick it right off. I mean, Tyrrell Hatton at 7.5 to 1 plus 750 as the clear outright favorite. Tommy Fleetwood opened at 10 to 1, Morikawa 14 to 1. It's pretty interesting to see Morikawa must have got a nice purse to come over here
Absolutely.
compared to playing at Torrey this week. And then Fitzpatrick at 16 to 1 using Bet365 opening prices from Monday morning. Are we fading the top of the board again, Tom?
I mean, we did it last week, and I found it really easy to do last week, and I find it even easier to do this week, and it's probably going to bite me in the bum again. But look, Tyrrell Hatton can do what he likes. He could win back to back. He's very capable of doing so. Tommy Fleetwood showed what I was concerned about last week. Colin Morikawa, I think there's something a little bit off with him. I know that's ridiculous to say with the form that he's in, but his putting is a problem. I think that PGA Championship win that he's been given so much credit for, which you can't take away from him, but that was TPC Harding Park. He'd spoken about how comfortable he was there. He'd played the greens more than anybody else had in his college career. So I think that when he gets the right spot and where he's comfortable, his putting is fine. When he's coming overseas, playing against guys that have played here 5, 6, 7 years in a row, that would be the difference maker for me. So that was why I found it slightly easy to oppose. Again, I spoke about Fitzpatrick being one that's difficult to oppose last week. I didn't find it as hard this week. I think that last week kind of suited him a little bit better. I think the wide openness of this event kind of takes out his strength. So yeah, it's a fade again and across everything.
Yeah, I'm backing up your stance. I mean, last week with Rory and JT, you would say two of the top five, maybe six golfers in the world. Now the conversation a lot revolves around is Hatton, the fourth wheel to the top three right now. Can you play fiddle with that? So to have those three realistically eating up so much win equity, it does make a little retrospective sense to see how that ended so well for those guys. But the places can pay more than, sometimes the outright winners on the European Tour. And that's what kind of thankfully came through with David Lipsky. So I'm willing to take the shots a little bit deeper down the board. We're going to really live in this next range, kind of starting at 25 to 1, and we go even up to 45 to 1. I'll open it up with my first pick. And you mentioned he lost in the playoff here last year. Christian Bezuidenhout, who for me has just been on a tear since he really, got his first monkey off his back with a win in 2019. He ripped off two consecutive wins in his home country in South Africa to close out his European Tour season last year. Bezuidenhout's game is built around the greens and on the greens, in a sense, a little bit Lucas Herbert has that spectacular putter that he can get into. And that's what Bezuidenhout is. I mean, when he was playing in some of those South Africa Tour events, or I guess a European Tour events in South Africa, he was just so much better than anybody else on the greens. He just looks like he commands his game. And to me, kind of that's what's going to take here. He's improving week by week off the tee in his ball striking game. And we know how good his short game is and his history here. I think at 25 to 1, he's going to be the first one on my card for the week.
The only thing, because he played a lot better than I expected him last week. I thought the score was going to get away from him. I think he likes it a lot tougher. And I think the thing that really stood out to me is he's played well here, but he played well here last year when it was really tough, like 9 under par final score. And that would be my concern, right? If he gets to 23, 24 under, he can't keep up with that. Having said that, he played better last week than I expected to. And as you referenced, his off the tee game is a lot, steadily progressing. To me, I just think he needs it a little bit tougher, and that would be the only concern for me.
Yeah, I mean, what his victory would have been, right, when it was extremely tough at the Andalusia Masters in 2019. I mean, he was one of the only guys under par at that event. And, to take it low at the Alfred Dunhill, is that a surprise? No, against what kind of the competition would have been at that event. But they're hanging a decent number. And again, if he's going to continue to improve like that, I'm willing to take that stand when he was arguably, a top five guy on the European Tour last year. I'll pass it to you. Who are you going with in this range to start?
So Andy Sullivan for me, he's a guy that the only concern I've got about him, if he doesn't go his way early on, he could check out mentally, right? That's the big concern. But he's got a 12th, 4th, 2nd, and 6th here. As I mentioned, the Portugal Masters is a nice correlation. He's got a win and a second there. He played so well last season. It was a really big comeback year for him. Hadn't won since 2015. When he did win in 2015, he's obviously got three wins, and I think he could stay in form for a really long period of time. He's fourth in the field over the last 15 weeks in tee to green. The only people ahead of him for me was Jaden Schaefer, and they always start in South Africa. Lipsky's only played one event, and Tyrrell Hatton, as we talked about. As you mentioned, Sky, 35 to 1 or 33 to 1, whatever price you can get about him, that is the range. His each way plays better than Hatton's win odds. So, even if he just finishes in the top five, he's got a great chance of doing so, and that's where I'm starting my card.
Yeah, I have no problems. To your point, I mean, Sully literally was, since the restart, I mean, arguably a top three or four guy on the European Tour, and he loves to take it low. I mean, those events that put in the 20s, that's when Sullivan's at its best.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it will suit him if it gets back to that as well. So I know another guy you have here is Sergio Garcia. And I got very close to him, as I discussed with you before the show. It's just the only thing with me is whether I almost kind of, it's ridiculous, but I'd almost rather take him to PGA Tour event in a couple of weeks' time when he might be 50s. That's my only concern.
Yeah, I mean, they hung a pretty decent, I mean, 30 to 1 at an open immediately, was bet. And they left it up for a little bit. I was fortunate to get on it. Now he sits probably even at some books. I've seen him to the teens. I think if you could find him as low as 22 to 25, that's probably my cutoff. But I'm willing to attack. Often these guys that come over from the PGA Tour in a little bit of form. I mean, Sergio's history at this course, he's won here before, third place finish a couple of years afterwards. Wasn't great his first start in Hawaii. I think he was like a 47th finish to round out there. It just seems the ball striking clinic that Sergio can put on is in a different class than those that are priced around him. So to get that early number, and again, I'm still willing to take it at 25 right now for Sergio. It just feels if he can get hot with the putter, which that's not, the Sergio we know. If he closes his
Shuts his
eyes,
eyes.
keeps it tight, I mean, at that point, potentially, he can hole a few of them for us, but he puts it so close that even if he makes, under the average of what he needs to, he's going to still be right there in contention. So I think anywhere from 22 to 30 on Sergio, I'm willing to accept.
The other thing here as well is there's a slight links element to it. If you look at the guys that have won, I mean, Stephen Gallagher's a two-time winner here, played incredibly well. He had that Portugal and Qatar Masters link, but he's also a links guy. That's his, that's what he's known for. Sergio Garcia is the same. Ernie Els is one here. Great links players. A lot of the best players on, generally speaking. Henrik Stenson's the same. There's a lot of links guys that perform well here, and I think that will play into Sergio's strengths, especially if the wind does get up. The next guy I'm going to go for is another Spaniard in Adrian Nelson, and I'm very, very critical of him. I have been for a very long period of time because. And I don't know why, because he's not even been around long enough for me to really make such a judgment on him. He's won on the Challenge Tour. He's beaten Bobby Mack in a big event there, and I'm willing to give him a chance. I got a 45 to 1, and that was a bigger places here in England. But he was tied third here last year, tied 29th the year before, 14th at the 2019 Qatar Masters, and he had a poor final round. The poor opening round, sorry, last week, where he had a 74, and he really bounced back from that and gained 7 strokes on the Friday tee to green after losing just as many the day before. And that to me just showed a great resilience to something that we haven't really seen from him. And if this is the sort of course that should suit him, which it should, it's wide open, he can deal with the wind if he needs to, I think it's a really good number for him.
Yeah, I mean, Arnas's ball striking in his rookie and into his sophomore year, I mean, it's right there with the top of the European Tour. He has been, struggling on Sundays at times when in contention. But he's falling into the category a little bit. He's just a little elevated above Robert McIntyre with the odds that he gets, even though McIntyre's win came in, the awkward showdown format. So Arnaas gets that deflation in a sense that he's been so many times up there that still, I mean, you can get the 45-1. I think that's fair. It's bound to happen. It's probably going to happen, when he's like in the 20s and we've given up on betting him. But 45 here, I mean, yes, I think that's very respectable. And you're hanging one more in this range too, correct?
I'm gonna go back to the old Victor Perez. I wasn't when I first spoke to you before, and I kind of wanted to avoid him. But then I thought back and I watched an awful lot of the golf over the weekend as I tried to. But off Fridays now, and I can get to sit and just put my feet up and watch every minute of every shot, which is painful if you've got a guy that can't putt. Luckily, Jordan Smith wasn't on TV very often, but. Victor Perez, he was within two shots of the lead in the third round, and then he just went nuclear, right? He had two double bogeys very in quick succession, and he just fell away. But what I like about it is he was there. He got himself in the mix. And when you just look at his bank of form in his career, he's won the Dunhill Links. He's won some really prestigious event in that, and played well at Wentworth, WGCs. This is definitely his level. He's very capable of winning here. You look at the list of winners, and even that he's in kind of in between the kind of Lucas Herberts and the top grade. He certainly fits the bill, the Hao Tong Lees, that sort of thing. And he's got bigger. He's 28-1 last week. He's 40-1 or 33-1, I think, this week as well. I think he's got a short memory, and I think he'll get over that kind of bad run where he just threw it away. He just got himself. I think he maybe pressed too hard, and that's easy to do when you're in contention.
Yeah, no, I'm a huge Perez believer in the game. Again, I think you'll hear us repeat it often, but the guys that stand out from the off the tee range this week, we're really honing in on, and that's what Perez and Arnaas both do. And again, you just have to get that uptick of short game, which Perez has shown in the past to really, come through for those opportunities to get yourself in contention. I'm going to bring it back as we go into a little bit deeper down the board. I filled myself with a few more long shots than I did last week. I ended up with six guys on my card. So we'll kind of start in the 80 range for me as I have another one here. And I'm going back to the well, just like you did with Perez. David Lipsky played amazing last week. And you said it. I mean, on Thursday, he lost 2.5 strokes putting. I mean, if he is able to, take advantage of that, he missed 2 4-footers on Sunday. I mean, he's given away strokes right there. I mean, that's 4 strokes, and he is neck and neck with Tyrrell Hatton if he's able to do that. I mean, he has some success at this course in the past. I mean, Lipsky was 11th here last year, 6 3 years ago. I just think the talent for what you're seeing, I mean, there was 90 with the each way to 6 places in the United States at one of the newer books that are offering out here. I know he was 75 at Open on Bet365. So it seems like with Lipsky, if you can grab the extra place after last week, you might want to take advantage of it. But I just think his game is too good to be priced down here. He's actually playing in Saudi next week too. So maybe we make it 3 in a row with Lipsky, but hopefully he can come through with another top finish for us.
The thing I think, Sky, was really important is that I think you got him at a price that he shouldn't have been. I think the price last week was wrong. I think 160, I think it was, that was way too big. I think he'd been forgotten about a little bit because he's been over to America. And now I think this price is still too big because I still think that I was worried there was going to be an overreaction to how well he played last week. And it hasn't really been. I mean, he can get some 90-1, 80-1. And he played so well in a stellar field. And like you say, he had the 6th and the 11th here. He's done it in different ways as well. He's led from the front. He's worked his way into it. Just quickly going back to Victor Perez because I've forgotten this. He was second going into the final round last year as well and had a horrendous day on in the wind. So something I just wanted to quickly go back to. But I don't think there's any shame in going back to Lipsky. I think he's a fantastic talent. He's won at this level, and I certainly think he's a good price here.
Yeah, and that's again, I think the talent for, I mean, the guy's gonna have a tour card 12 months from now. You can't say that about more than anybody, you know, less than 33 to one, pretty much, you know, in this field. So to say that, and the way he's earning it, of course, is different than the other guys with the opportunity he has on the Korn Ferry Tour, but it just stands about for me. And I know this guy that you're going to talk to us about next happened to be one of the COVID withdrawals last week. There was a couple of them. Unfortunately, one happened to me after lock with Andrew Beef Johnston. I don't really know. Sometimes it's tough to find the news right now. Thor is in the field right now. So you're going back to him, right? Triple digits almost.
Yeah. I mean, so he's 100 to 1 on our, you know, this side of the pond. And I don't know whether he's ill with COVID or whether he just tested positive or it was a false positive or it was a scare. So he definitely tested positive, but I don't know how accurate that result was. If he's back in the field, I suggest he's testing negative since then. And I guess he's feeling well. The thing with Thor is that, you know, he had a long period of time away from golf, and I don't want to get into why, but it would have bothered him, okay? You know, there's things that have been in the back of his mind. He can't concentrate on golf, and that's absolutely fine. Since he's come back, he struggled early on, but just recently showing signs of really getting back to his best. And if that is the case, then, wow, this is the perfect course for him, because he's had T3 here in 2013, T5 2014, and he's an 8th and 7th since then as well. 2nd and 3rd at Qatar, where he could have won both times. Tied 13th last time out. It's a while ago now, obviously, before Christmas. We had 4 rounds under par, 64 on the Friday. And he had T28 in Cyprus as well. And it was a poor final round, really, that cost him. He was only 4 back going into that final day. And we can see he's the type of guy that can get hot. And that 4-shot, you know, deficit wouldn't have been a big problem. Kevin Shinkwin, who won, was only 2 behind. So there's only 2-shot swing. And that sort of course, anything can happen. So he was playing great golf. And for me, 100 to 1 about a guy that is, I mean, before, if this, it's ridiculous to say this thing didn't happen because it did, but this guy would have been 33 to 1 at max back before that all happened.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Thorbjørn Olsen is a 5-time European Tour winner. You know, that Italian Open when he dueled out Molinari with that epic putt he hit on 18 in 2018. I mean, that's when he was climbing up 3rd at the Bridgestone, you know, I think a couple weeks afterwards. I mean, he was up there as the next guy coming over from Europe to make noise on the PGA Tour. The books will continue to put those numbers out for him as he's shaking off the rust. But, you know, you take advantage of these spots. People are going to probably do the same with Gary Woodland, you know, at the Farmers this week, 75. Molinari's hanging around there. This is the similar situation on the European Tour with somebody who was at the top of the game 2 years ago, fighting his way back. So yeah, I mean, I can't fault you with Olsen's talent in that range. I'm going to take it deeper for the next one here. And you mentioned him earlier as one of the top golfers off the tee in his limited amount of events that he has played. Again, you're going to notice as we keep going through these shows, I have, you know, the love for these golfers who are coming through the amateur ranks, potentially even the junior ranks, that really had a prolific kind of winning kind of careers up to this point before turning pro. And I'm going to be going to Jayden Trey Skaper at 150 to 1. I mean, Skaper came onto the scene for his first real event 2020 to start the year at the South African Open. Finished T6. Since then, he played on the Sunshine Tour, you know, was one of the best players. Again, I mean, this kid is still in his teens. You know, you can see him out there, how young he is. He played in final groups with Louis Oosthuizen. You know, Skaper, I think, has the ball striking game. I mean, off the tee, he's electric. Approach game is really, really good. And I mean, he took it, what, 2nd to Bezaden, who at the Alfred Dunhill Championship, unfortunately, I think he drove it OB on the 10th hole on that day where people were driving that par 4 and lost a ball, which ended up being a triple bogey, bounces back with a birdie, just couldn't catch Bezaden, who I think the game of this kid is long-term. And again, I'm going to try to be early on him at 150 to 1. And again, there might be going to be some deeper numbers out there with each way, because those places are playing 30, 40 to one. You know, I think Skaper is just such a good talent.
And two things I want to touch on there is that, first of all, he lost out to Christian Bezaden. Okay, now this is a guy that is the best player in the world, you know, from his country. You've got Louis Oosthuizen, you've got, you know, other guys like that, but he, in form, he's the best guy, right? So he's got him to duel out in his home country, goes for it, and puts himself out of bounds. So at least he went for it. That's the thing. He's young, he's hungry. And what people, I don't know if anyone knows, but he actually played here last year. So he's got 2 rounds under his belt. He missed a cut on the number. So it's not like he was poor here. which suggests that he could play well. The course is wide open. If he goes down the typical South African range, then the links golf should play into his effect. So I really like him. I think, like we've spoken about, he's a guy that is the long-term goal, right? He's someone that can, there's so much potential with him. Another guy, Wilco Nijhuis, like we said, I think this will be a better course than it was for him last week. That could go well. Laurie Cantor's another one in that range that you think that these guys can bounce back. It's really easy, and I'm really guilty of just getting away from these guys after one missed cut. I mean, Laurie Cantor was like 4 under through five, to start off last week. He missed the cut, and that was it. My deepest bet of the week is Nacho Elvira. He was 11th here in 2017. He was fourth after round one, second after round two, and crumbled over the weekend, which is kind of his game. He's lost two playoffs though, where he got beaten rather than lost it. They're beaten by birdies. He's played his two top tens in the Portugal Masters that I keep alluding to, two top tens in the Qatar Masters. He likes this part of the world. And 11th and the 16th here, both of which he's sort of been in and around the lead. I thought 250, I think it's 225 over there. Huge number. I mean, he played, pretty good golf last week. He had one bad round where he probably realized where he was in the field, who is against, it happens. But this guy has got talent. He's been close to victory. Like I said, he's only lost two playoffs. It's not like he's, never even contended. He's had that experience. And I think he's a huge number this week. And he'd be certainly someone I'd be looking at with draft.
I mean, what, if you remember that lightning strike, wasn't it in the Maybank Championship against Scott Hend, kind of the massive boom during his putting stroke or one of his chips that ended up forcing that playoff. Then he hits the long putt to get there. Hend obviously got him in the end of it. But yeah, Nacho can pop up from time to time. So again, your course correlations are things where there is comfort level, and that can play a factor on the European Tour when there is more variance. I'm going to finish us off here with two more guys. One of them you guys should know coming. I warned you last week. We'll leave him for the final one. But the first one I will go with is Takumi Kanaya. So Takumi Kanaya, he's made appearance in the Sony Open, missed the cut on the number just 2 weeks ago in Hawaii. Kanaya was the world number one amateur in 2019. I mean, he has had a little bit of kind of around the world experience so far, mainly playing on the Japanese golf tour where he got his first victories. Two of them, one as an amateur in 2019, one as a professional, I believe, at the Dunlop Phoenix, which is no joke of an event, probably their best event that they run over here. And then I guess, the one that kind of stood out to me is the third place that he had at the Australian Open. That's the one that Matt Jones won, where Oosthuizen was in the event. I mean, he beat Tringali, he beat Paul Casey, he beat Leishman, Scrivener, some really talented guys that were in the event where he was able to. And again, you're getting some bomb numbers, I believe, at least a 150. I think I saw a 200 floating around on BetRivers here in the States, which offers the each way. So Kanaya's the one. And then the final one to close us out for the week. Again, I prepped you every single week. I'm going to be betting my guy, just like the PGA Tour. You saw Siwoo come through last week. You stick with the guys. Unfortunately for me, they're offering 250 to 1 on Guido Migliazzi. And Guido is back, folks. You won't realize it because he missed the cut last week. But if you pull the approach numbers, which Guido in 2 years ago on the European Tour was one of the best approach players in the entire tour, just couldn't make a putt for the life of him. And last week, he bounced back. He gained 3 strokes approach in just those two rounds that he played. He was pretty solid off the tee. He is long term a really good off the tee player. Again, he just could not sink anything on the greens, lost 4 strokes in his two rounds. So there's 250s out there on Guido. That to me, with the upside that you can get, he's going to place once or twice this year, and that's going to pay you enough to keep on getting your Guido money in. So that's how I round out my card. Tom, let's run it back for you from the top. Who are the five golfers you are on this week?
Yes, I've gone for Andy Sullivan, Adrian Ause, Victor Perez, Thorbjørn Olesen, depending on the COVID situation there, and Nacho Elvira is my bomb long shot for the week. A couple of guys I just want to mention for DraftKings purposes. I think that Alexander Bjork could be someone to keep an eye on. I think his approach number's been great. Randy some form, likes this part of the world. Stephen Gallagher, right? He's a two-time winner here, second and the third as well, 16th last week. So it's probably going to be ownership's probably going to be higher than what, you know, the trust that you can put in him. But he's someone that if the ownership, you know, towards the end of the week is looking quite low, then he's worth looking at. And Chris Paisley as well. I mean, he's a guy, you know, I've had him on the podcast. He spoke to me at the start of the year. He said he'd been putting in some really good work on the off-season, finished tied seventh. You know, he wasn't in contention, but he rolls the rock. Okay, he's a putter. He puts the lights out, and he loves this part of the world. He played well here twice before. And someone to keep an eye on, certainly.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, you kind of find those long shots that sub, you know, 7K sometimes on DraftKings like Gallagher is like you just get minuscule ownership for some of these guys that have upside. And as we roll through my card here, again, we have Christian Bezuidenhout 25-1 to lead it off. Sergio Garcia, there was again the 30 at open. I'm good anywhere in the 20s for Sergio. Then we start getting our each ways in as we get deeper down the board. David Lipsky, there was 75-1. I've seen up to 90, hoping to run it back with Lipsky. Jaden Trey Scaper, 150-1. Takumi Kanaya, 200. And Guido Migliazzi, 250-1. Tom, let's hear about Lost for Words, your podcast that you have, and where they can find you on Twitter.
Yeah, so Lost for Words, you can find us on Apple, you can find us on Spotify. We've just done God knows how many hours of this event, so we've lost track of time there. Tom Jacobs 93 on Twitter. I'll post some sort of rants on there. I'll try and get a hat sponsorship. That doesn't work. I'm better than Justin Thomas in terms of, you know, forming in front of your sponsors, so think about that. I didn't go to Cal University, so this is a borrowed one. Look, you know, this is a place where I urge you to come out and reach out to us, because there's guys that we can't mention. Okay, this is, you know, it's a short form video. It's something that there's going to be so many guys that we haven't got a chance to mention. If you've got a guy you want to talk about, let us know. Put it in the comments on YouTube. Anything you want us to look at, we can certainly help you there.
Absolutely. Again, my name's Skylar Hoke. You can find me on Twitter at SkyHookeDFS. I'm a part of FTN Daily, FTN Bet. So every Tuesday, I will go through the DraftKings salary for the European Tour. Again, this show is getting recorded in the late afternoon Eastern Standard Time. This is deep into the evening for Tom, but on EST here, it's about 5:30. So salaries just were getting dropped. I'll get a deeper look tomorrow for that. So you can find that video on FTN Daily. And then I do as well, a little quick hitter podcast with Axis every Monday and Tuesday called The Alternate Shot. You can find us on all the platforms, but please, Mayo Media Network, second week, European Tour, picks and bets. Subscribe to our channel. Take in the great content we'll be delivering each and every week for the European Tour. We love the support. It was an awesome first week, and we look forward to interacting with you guys in the future. Thanks, Tom.
Yeah, thank you guys for tuning in. It's really great to see you.